Welcome to Art History from a Queer Perspective, Vignettes During the Virus. This is number three. Special thanks to Ann Jacobs for the donation that made this video presentation possible. I'm Liz Bradbury, Director of the Training Institute of the Bradbury-Sullivan LGBT Community Center. At the Community Center, I teach cultural competency trainings on LGBT issues, and for organizations and businesses. But also at the center, I teach Art History from a Queer Perspective classes twice a year, 4 classes each. But we can't do it this year because of social distancing. So I'm presenting in real time a series of vignettes, Art History from a Queer Perspective, Vignettes During the Virus, number 3. So this is number 3 of the series, and these are shorter than our regular classes. This one is about Charlotte Cushman. Here she is. And this is for Lesbian Visibility Week. This is the last one that I'm doing specifically for Lesbian Visibility Week, which was this week. Next week, I'll be starting on vignettes from other parts of the queer community. Charlotte Cushman was, without a doubt, the most famous actor, woman actor, of the 1800s. When people wanted to sell tickets, all they had to do was put her name in big letters in the advertisement, and people would come and plunk down money to see her. It's bigger than the name of the play. It's bigger than the theater's name. All they had to do was put Cushman, and people would come and see her. She was born in Boston. She had a captivating contralto voice. She sang opera when she was 13 years old. Her father had died. She needed to go out and support her family. She already had established that she had a beautiful voice, and they got her to be in opera presentations from that age. She ended up becoming a tragic actress, and she played Lady Macbeth at the age of 19, and she played throughout Boston and New Orleans and Albany, and she was a terrific success. She was a genius, by the way. People don't say that enough about women who are artists and actors, but she's a genius. Here's Charlotte Cushman. She was also a lesbian. Now, here she is playing Meg Merrilees in a play called Guy Mannering. She was young when she played this. It's one of her first roles and one of the first pictures of her playing. It's sort of a painted picture. She was so good in this character part that she scared the audience. They were literally afraid when they saw her. But Edwin Booth, the famous actor of the 1800s, probably the most famous actor of the 1800s, and of course he was the brother of John Wilkes Booth, who shot Lincoln. But Edwin Booth was extraordinarily famous, and he told her, stop playing character parts, because if you do, you're going to be stuck in character parts for the rest of your life. Stick with tragic acting. You want to be the lead. Well, she did, and she became the lead in plays, and she was incredibly famous. But why don't we know who she is today? What is it about that? I mean, we know about old-time women movie stars. We know about some of the musical stars of the early 1900s. Why don't we know about Charlotte Cushman? And the answer to that is that we don't have movies of her. We don't have recordings of her. It's not like Mary Cassatt, who painted paintings, and we can see those paintings today and understand her art. Charlotte Cushman's work was in real time, and there's no record of it. So we don't know who she is. And part of this is that she's not extraordinarily beautiful. And so she didn't have that. What she had was a stage presence that people just couldn't forget. And yet that generation is gone. The people who saw her are not around to tell us about it anymore. Here she is playing Macbeth. She's actually playing the male part of Macbeth, and she played this. This is her later in life. Here she is, younger, playing the male part of Hamlet. Now, here she is in Romeo and Juliet, the Shakespeare play, of course. And there's the advertisement for it. Miss Cushman. There it says Miss Cushman. Doesn't even have to have her first name. But here's the thing. She's playing Romeo. She's playing Romeo in this. And it says that down at the bottom. And this person is Susan Cushman, who was her sister who played Juliet. And they traveled around the country playing Romeo and Juliet. It was a huge success. Here she is, Charlotte Cushman, playing Lady Macbeth. So she played women's parts too. Her acting was brilliant. Her voice was epic. And she played, when she played these male parts, those were known as breeches parts. She also mentored many lesbian artists in Rome, and we'll see that in a second. But here she is again in Romeo and Juliet. This painting is her as Romeo and then her sister Susan as Juliet. Now this painting is one of her at an earlier age. She was 27 in this, and you can see that she was extraordinarily beautiful. And she has a look on her face that is significant. So let's talk about that. This painting is by Thomas Sully, who was a very, very famous portrait painter. As a matter of fact, he painted the portrait of Alexander Hamilton that was taken from that portrait on the $20 bill. So you've probably been carrying around a portrait by Thomas Sully many times in your life. This is when she was 27 years old. She was in Philadelphia. She was acting in Philadelphia, and she stayed at Thomas Sully's house. Now, this is a miniature of her painted by Rosalie Sully. Now, if you look at the face, so miniature paintings, in those days, you couldn't get photographs in 1843. There weren't any photographs that you could just get. So miniaturist artists would paint these little paintings that are about the size of the palm of your hand that you could carry around with you and look at your loved one. And this painting really looks like somebody who is in love. Well, Rosalie Sully was in love with Charlotte Cushman, and Charlotte Cushman was in love with Rosalie. They were staying in the same house, in Thomas Sully's house. And I have to say that if you look at this lovelorn, you know, this loving, not lovelorn, but picture of Charlotte Cushman in love with Rosalie, in the miniature, it looks one way. If you look at the way Thomas Sully painted her, you can see that he has painted the devil in her eyes. She knows something, and what she knows is she's in love with Rosalie, and Thomas Sully probably knew that too. She doesn't look innocent in that picture at all, as she does in the miniature. So Charlotte loved Rosalie, and she gave her a wedding ring. They swore eternal love to each other. They exchanged rings. But Charlotte needed, after a while, she had really conquered the United States, particularly the East Coast, and she needed to go to Europe to become an international star. That's what famous people did in those days. They needed to conquer Europe, but you know, America was a usurper. That wasn't where the real fame was. She needed to go to Paris and to London and to Rome and to impress people in Europe. And so she said to Rosalie, come with me. I want you, you know, we're in love, come with me. And Rosalie said, well, I'm not ready to go yet. You go ahead. And so Charlotte left. She went to Europe, and she was the toast of Europe. People loved her, and she started to make an enormous amount of money. She was very, very wealthy, really rapidly. And she wrote love letters to Rosalie, said, come here. You can live with me. We'll have a wonderful time. You can paint. Just come now. And Rosalie said, I can't. I'm afraid. I'm afraid to leave the United States. I'm afraid to leave my father. I'm afraid to be around people I don't know. And that ended their relationship. Now, this is a picture of Rosalie. She's beautiful. And here she is holding her painting gear. This is actually by her father, Thomas Sully. And that ended their relationship. I also want to show you this painting. This is the same painting. It's the same painting as the other painting. And it's important to remember that when you see a picture of a painting, like a photograph of the painting, it doesn't always look the way the painting really looks. If you want to see the way the painting really looks, go look at the painting, because it could be the light, it could be how clean the painting is, it could be just the way that it was color balanced in the photograph itself. So Charlotte's in Europe, and she's become the toast of Europe, and she's brilliant, and everybody is impressed by her. And she has performed for Abraham Lincoln and William Seward, who was the Secretary of State under Grant, I think. Abraham Lincoln, yeah. And he was the one who bought the territory of Alaska. So he's a famous guy. Queen Victoria, she played for Queen Victoria, and she became very, very wealthy. And she encouraged other women's careers. other artists, other writers, particularly if she was in relationships with them. But she was really very supportive of other women's careers. And she established herself. Let's see. Charlotte Cushman's fans adored her. She mesmerized admirers. So here she is with an admirer. This woman is Matilda Hayes. And she was a translator, a novelist, a journalist. She saw Charlotte in a play and she fell hard for her. She really was entranced by her. She was like a stalker, like a fan stalker, and she stalked Charlotte until Charlotte sort of gave in. And they became lovers, and they lived together for 10 years in Rome, and they were in a committed couple. In fact, they were known publicly as a couple. As a matter of fact, Elizabeth Barrett Browning commented, "I understand that she," meaning Charlotte Cushman, "and Miss Hayes have made vows of celibacy." Now, of course, vows of celibacy means they're not going to have sex with men. "And of eternal attachment," so to speak, "to each other. They live together. They dress alike. It is a female marriage." Now, look at the picture. They are absolutely dressed exactly alike. They're wearing the same little ties. They've got the same outfits on. That's what happens to older couples after a while. You might want to look at your clothes and see if your partner is wearing exactly the same clothes as you are if you've been together for more than 10 years. Charlotte and Matilda Hayes lived in Rome in Charlotte's villa. She had an extraordinary villa in Rome that was large and supportive, and lots of young artists and sculptors who were lesbians or women who may have identified as bisexual or may have identified as straight, but these women all had set up an artist colony in Rome, particularly from the 1840s to the 1860s, and they really prospered there. And she was the center of it. So Matilda, and you can see again, this is a close-up of, they're wearing exactly the same outfit. Matilda Hayes, after a while, after they'd been together for most of the 10 years, she started to get bored with Charlotte for some unknown reason, because Charlotte was great. And she ended up having an affair with Harriet Hosmer. So this is Harriet Hosmer. She was another sculptor who was a friend of theirs, who had ended up, who was also in Rome and who was a very successful sculptor. She was very successful. And as a matter of fact, this is Hattie Hosmer in the center. She's the woman in the center, a little short woman. And all these guys are her workers. This is her staff. She actually made a living creating and selling her sculptures without being rich before that. She would create and design these sculptures. She would make a sculpture. She created herself after she designed the whole thing. And then these guys would come and copy them. And then she would work on them. And then she'd work on them with them. And then they'd sell those sculptures to tourists or Victorian people who would want to spend money to have them in their homes. So anyway, Matilda Hayes is now with Harriet Hosmer. She kind of moves into Harriet's big villa because she has a big house too. So Charlotte, no slouch her, she never wants to be alone. So in her villa, she encourages Margaret Foley to move in with her. Margaret Foley is another sculptor that she knows. And this is not her. This is a sculpture that Margaret Foley made. Maybe similar to her, because people often make things that are autobiographical or that are their own, you know, pictures. But Margaret Foley was living with Charlotte. So now Matilda is a little uncomfortable about that. She's tired of Harriet Hosmer, who is known as Hattie, and is jealous of Charlotte's new squeeze. So Matilda decides to dump Harriet Hosmer and goes back to Charlotte Cushman, just like nothing happened. "Hi, I'm back." And Charlotte says, okay, all right. But Charlotte confides to a friend, "I never really asked for this relationship." Remember that Matilda was a stalker. She was a fan. And Charlotte didn't really pursue her. Matilda pursued Charlotte. And then she left her, which was, I think, hard for Charlotte. So she lets Matilda come back into the house. She lets her move back in. She's pretty generous. Charlotte is universally generous throughout her lifetime. So she lets Matilda come back into the house. And Hattie Hosmer, so now Hattie doesn't have a girlfriend because Matilda's moved out, but no grass grows under her feet. So she takes up with this woman whose name is Emma Stebbins. And she's also a very successful sculptor. Very interesting, well-read woman. This is a painting of her, of Emma Stebbins when she was young, quite a beautiful woman. And so Emma Stebbins is with Harriet Hosmer, but Emma Stebbins then goes to a play of Charlotte Cushman. There's a play in Rome that Charlotte Cushman is doing, and Emma Stebbins goes to it. And of course, Emma, gasp, falls in love with Charlotte. Charlotte also falls in love with Emma, and she's really impressed by Emma. And I think that it might be a little bit of attraction for her that this was Hattie's girlfriend that she's taking away since Hattie took away her girlfriend. But anyway, Charlotte Cushman really is impressed by Emma Stebbins, and she is excited about her, and she begins a relationship with her. Meanwhile, Matilda Hayes comes home one day, and she finds Charlotte writing a love note to Emma. She's got it in her hand, and she sees it. She says, "What's this? What's this?" And Charlotte says, "Uh-oh." And Matilda Hayes starts chasing Charlotte around the house with fists flying. She's trying to beat her up. And she says, "You bitch!" And she says, "I demand alimony," because she says, "Look, I took care of you for those 10 years. I did all that work." And Charlotte in her mind is going, "Yeah, but you did walk out on me." But still, she wants alimony. She wants maintenance. She wants to move out. And Charlotte actually, is quite generous. And so without fighting her, she says, all right, I'll give you enough money to live on. And she does. And she gives Matilda Hayes enough money to live on. Matilda moves out. And now Emma Stebbins moves in with Charlotte Cushman, and they're an item. They're together now. And as a matter of fact, they have a marriage ceremony, they swear eternal love to each other, and they live together in love until the end of Charlotte Cushman's life, which isn't until the 1870s, the late 1870s. Emma Stebbins is a real sculptor, and she designed this famous fountain. Does anybody know what this sculpture is? This is the Bethesda Fountain in Central Park, New York. You can see it today. You can see this beautiful fountain, and when you do, you can say that's Charlotte Cushman's girlfriend, Emma Stebbins, designed that beautiful fountain. Go see it. Don't, for that last little thing said, don't worry about Matilda Hayes and Harriet Hosmer. They went right out and got some other girlfriends. They're lesbians, after all, that would happen. So Charlotte, being Charlotte, there's more to the love story. So don't hesitate. Don't think that that's the end of the story. Because here's what happens. While Emma Stebbins is working on sculpture, Charlotte goes on a U.S. tour. Now, Charlotte did this periodically. By now, she didn't appear in plays as much as just going and doing recitations. And when she did that, people would line up because she would go to every little backwater town. She probably came to Allentown and Easton, to the big theaters there at Bethlehem, where she was very, very wealthy. So she probably had her own train car. I believe she did have her own train car, which was like a mobile home, like on the bus, but it was attached to a train. She'd pull into a city or a town. She'd go and do a performance, or a couple of nights she'd do a performance, and then people would see her and they would line up. And she literally made millions of dollars doing that. So while she was in the Midwest, she stayed with her friend who was a state senator and a wealthy businessman. His name was Wayman Crow, and she had known him for a long time. She had visited him earlier when she was in the U.S. He was in St. Louis, and she actually earlier, she'd been traveling with Hattie Hosmer across the country, which she was probably in a relationship with Hattie. By the time they got to Wayman Crow's, Hattie Hosmer had a relationship with Crow's daughter, Cornelia Crow, who was his older daughter. By the time that Charlotte came there, she had a younger daughter named Emma. And here is Emma Crow. Just to be confusing, her name is Emma as well. Everybody was named Emma in those days. So this is Emma Crow, lovely young woman. And she was 19, and she went to see Charlotte in a play. Okay, what happens when a young lesbian goes to see Charlotte in a play? She fell in love with her. And remember, they're living in the same house. So she's suddenly in love with Charlotte. She's over heels in love with her. And Charlotte really didn't discourage her. Charlotte liked to have people adore her. And so, at least to her credit, she did tell young Emma that she was married, that Charlotte was married to Emma Stebbins, and she was in love with her. And she said, I'm not going to give up on that relationship for you, my dear. I love this person. But, but there she was, together with Emma. And in reality, Emma was devoted to her. She's kneeling at Charlotte's feet in this photo. So they start to write love notes to each other, and some of them were quite erotic, or at least very obviously romantic. Charlotte continues her U.S. tour. And as she goes around the United States, she's still writing letters to Emma, and she says to Emma, okay, look, I'm going to write you these letters. They're romantic. But you have to promise to burn these letters, because if anybody finds these, it's going to ruin your reputation. It's going to ruin my career. And you have to promise to burn these letters, or I'm not going to write you romantic letters anymore. I'll just write you, hi, how are you doing? And, you know, I was in a play. And so Emma Crow absolutely agrees to destroy all of the romantic letters that Charlotte sent to her. And so now Charlotte, after her tour, returns to Europe. But while she's in Europe, and now she's back in Rome with Emma Stebbins, Emma Crow insists she wants to come to Europe. She says to Charlotte in a letter, my father is going to pay for me to go on a grand tour of Europe. I'm going to travel around Europe. But the main reason I'm coming is that I want to come and stay with you and see you in your villa in Rome. And Charlotte misses Emma, and she agrees because Charlotte likes her. She likes that she's writing and she's in love with her and devoted to her. So Charlotte goes. Emma goes to Charlotte's villa, and she travels there, and she visits Charlotte in the villa. And there's Charlotte. Now Charlotte's older. You know, she's probably in her 50s by now. And frankly, Emma never really leaves Charlotte again for the rest of Charlotte's life. She moves into the villa, and she stays there forever. And she travels with Charlotte for the rest of her life. Emma Crow, in order to make it seem more proper, ends up marrying Charlotte's nephew, Ned. Now, remember, Charlotte had a sister named Susan. Well, her son, Ned, is also living with her in Rome. In fact, everybody's sponging off of Charlotte in Rome. She has an enormous villa. So all of her family's there, her mother's there, her sister, and Ned is there. And so Emma Crow marries Ned. But Ned is often known to say, you know, I hardly ever see her. She's always with Charlotte. Now, Emma Stebbins is there too. And they're all there together. And so there you see is Emma Crow with Charlotte. But Emma Stebbins is also there. And she must have understood that Emma Crow was in love with Charlotte. After all, she had gone through all of those relationships. She knew what that was like. Though Ned never really got it that Charlotte and Emma were in love. So Emma Crow lives with Charlotte's home for the rest of Charlotte's life in what was seems to have been a polyamorous family relationship. There's all these people involved in this relationship. And in a few years, Emma has a baby by Ned. And here's Emma Crow with her baby. Interestingly, you know, you got to get the sperm from someplace. And here's the big punchline. Look at this kid. She looks just like Charlotte. After all, Charlotte is her great aunt. But I mean, how interesting it is. And as I said, you have to get the sperm from someplace. So Charlotte Cushman's women. So these are all of her women. So there's Emma Stebbins and Emma Crow and Matilda Hayes, her ex-girlfriend. And there's Rosalie Sully, her ex-girlfriend. And there's Harriet Hosmer, who's probably had been her girlfriend, but she's also the ex-girlfriend of her ex-girlfriend. And there's Anna Brewster. Anna Brewster was actually Charlotte's first girlfriend. She was a journalist in Rome. She was older than Charlotte. And there is a poet named Eliza Cook. She was also a girlfriend, probably between Anna Brewster and Rose Sully. And this woman, whose name is Edmonia Lewis, she was the most famous African-American artist of the 1800s, of men and women. She was internationally famous. She was actually probable girlfriend of Harriet Hosmer. She lived with Harriet Hosmer. She knew Charlotte. I'll probably do another vignette about her. She had a very interesting life. And of course, there's Margaret Foley, who temporarily lived with Charlotte in her villa. And then these are, I threw these people in. This is Anne Manning and, it's Abby Manning and Anne Whitney. Anne Whitney was a famous sculptor. Abby Manning was a sculptor and also the partner. And they were long-term partners. They stayed together for 50 years. They didn't have any other girlfriends. They were absolutely committed to each other and they were buried in the same grave. So you don't have to presume that all lesbians have dozens of different partners. And she had other friends too. Geraldine Jewsbury, Jane Carlyle, they were writers. Elizabeth Barrett Browning and Robert Browning were friends with her. Elizabeth Ney, who was a sculptor, Louise Landers, Florence Freeman, all these people were, you know, every other famous person was going in and out of Charlotte's place in Rome. She also had other homes at other places that were very significant as well, that people visited her all the time. So here's the question, and you probably are asked, some people may be asking this, how do I know that these people were lesbians? How do I know that they were having physical relationships with each other and they weren't just really good friends? Well, there's an answer to that. These women wrote letters to each other. They wrote graphic letters to each other. And remember how Charlotte told Emma Crow, you've got to burn the letters. And Emma absolutely promises to burn the letters. Well, imagine you're a 19-year-old young lesbian and you fall in love with Meryl Streep. And Meryl Streep is in love with you. And she writes you love letters. Or Cher. Or what other famous actress? You know, I'm not that good at contemporary people, but somebody who was so famous and so beautiful, some incredible musician or something like that. And they're writing you love letters and you're a teenager or you're young in your young 20s and you have these beautiful love letters and they say you have to burn the letters. Would you do it? Of course not. You wouldn't do it. And Emma Crow did not burn the letters. She had Charlotte Cushman's letters till the day she died. They were in her effects. And now scholars have used them to determine what their relationship was. And I'm glad that's true because they weren't discovered that to the detriment of either of these people, but they were found to for scholarly circumstances so that we know that these people really were in relationships because they described the kinds of relationships that they were in. They kept the letters. Everybody kept the letters. Same thing happened with Emily Dickinson. She said to her sister when she died, you have to destroy all the letters, and she did. But Emily Dickinson, like Charlotte Cushman, wrote beautiful letters and other people kept them. And that's how we know what's in the letters. That's how we know that Emily Dickinson loved Sue Gilbert because she wrote her 300 love letters. Charlotte Cushman was so famous that her name was on cigar boxes to sell the cigars. This probably wasn't even licensed because in reality, this looks nothing like Charlotte Cushman at all. But here's something that does look like her. This is a Staffordshire figure that was made in about 1850. Staffordshire made these different figures. That's how they produced ceramics, beautiful ceramics. This is about 18 inches tall. And this is really from the period. You could buy this to commemorate Romeo and Juliet. But this isn't just Romeo and Juliet. This is actually Charlotte Cushman and Susan Cushman playing Romeo and Juliet because that's what it says on that sort of white half-round thing on the front of the base of the sculpture. It says Charlotte Cushman as Romeo and Susan Gilbert, Susan Cushman as Juliet. So we know, so I wish I had one of these statues. If you have one, I would love to buy it from you. But and you can still get them. You can see them on eBay now and then. So these are extraordinary things. They're like tchotchkes. And, you know, we see this kind of stuff now. We see like action heroes and stuff, little plastic action heroes that you can get from McDonald's. Or you can get the, I missed it. Let's see. Let's go back. Let's go back because I really want you to see that. There we go. There. Or you could get this Rosie O'Donnell doll. I actually have a Rosie O'Donnell doll. And this is, you know, this is Rosie. She's a lesbian. She has a plastic-sized Barbie. You know, it's the same kind of thing. It's exactly the same kind of thing. These weren't high art things with the Staffordshire figure. They were commemoratives. When Charlotte Cushman died, or when she retired from the stage in New York, they had a ticker tape parade because she was so famous. There were bands, there were marching people, there were horses, there were dignitaries, the mayor was there to commemorate her life as an actor. And she died in 1876 in Boston at the age of 59 from breast cancer. And you can see this parade, which is in New York City. In 1907, as a tribute to her, the first Charlotte Cushman Club was established in Philadelphia, and it was a hotel for traveling actresses where actresses could stay in a safe place. That was in place until about 15 years ago when they stopped using it as a hotel for actresses. Charlotte Cushman was a brilliant figure in American history. She was a lesbian. We all know it. It was really cool. You could get this painting of her in theaters that's supposed to be her eye. And I'm not sure if this really looks like her, but it's really weird and yet pretty interesting. Thank you very much for watching. Please like and subscribe. Read more about Charlotte Cushman in a variety of different books. She's a fascinating character. I'm Liz Bradbury, Director of the Training Institute of the Bradbury-Sullivan LGBT Community Center. I present a variety of art and history from a queer perspective classes on dozens of different topics of art, from cave painting to pop art. You can read about or you can see some of the other vignettes that I've done on our website at Bradbury Sullivan Center. And if you'd like to be a donor to allow more of these to go on, please contact me. Also, I do trainings on cultural competency, on LGBT equity, and on LGBT health disparities and other LGBT issues. Please contact us about trainings. You can read more about the classes and the trainings on our website at www.bradburysullivancenter.org. In the program section, see Training Institute. Contact me for further information or to donate to enable future vignettes during the virus. Contact me about that. I'd love to talk about it. And finally, special thanks to Ann Jokums for the donation that made this video presentation possible. Take care. Stay inside. Be kind.